Now we arrive at the very important topic of Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization. This is also known as the Gram-Schmidt process. It starts with a set of linearly independent vectors, and it results in a set of mutually orthonormal vectors that span the same space as those original vectors did. So what about orthogonal bases, or orthonormal bases? Here's the problem statement, using the case where you have three vectors as an example. We start with three vectors. We would like to find three vectors, q0 through q2, such that the span of those three vectors is the same as the span of the three vectors with which we start. And how do we do that? Well, step one is to normalize A. How do we visualize that? So here we visualize these three vectors, a0, a1, and a2. Now, they're a little bit hard to see until we start rotating this picture. And what you notice is that a0 and a1 are in the plane that we colored blue, and then a2 sticks out of that plane, so it's not in the space spans by the vectors a0, a1. And we also notice that a0 and a1 are not perpendicular to each other, and it's probably a little bit harder to see whether a2 is perpendicular to a0 and a1. We'll have a better look at that later. Here we visualize the first step of the Gram-Schmidt process. Let's let this spin for a little bit until we get a good view of this. That's probably good enough. We start with the vector a0. We want the vector of length 1 in the same direction as a0. So the thick black arrow here is in the same direction as a0, but is now of length 1. So what is it that we just did in our visualization? We took our vector A and we made it of length 1 by dividing it by its length. And we then called the result vector of that q0. Another way of looking at that is that we first computed a scalar. Later we're going to see that calling that scalar row 0, 0 is convenient. And then we divided a0 by row 0, 0, which is then equivalent to dividing a0 by its length. The result of that is one vector, q0, in the direction of a0 of length 1. So if we do this for our example, we feed in the vector 1, 1, 1, we compute its length, which is the square root of 3, and then we take that vector, we divide it by its length, q3, and there are several different ways in which we could write it. It's going to turn out that writing it like this is going to be quite convenient later on. Or, of course, you can multiply through and end up with this vector that's the square root of 3 over 3 for each of its components. Let's see what we have to do to compute q1 orthogonal to q0. In this step, we want to compute the component of a1 perpendicular to q0 and then normalize that to be of size 1. So how does that work? Well, let's let this picture rotate into a little bit better. There, that should be good. What we have here is the vector a1, which is of some length. The component of a1 in the direction of the vector q0 is given by the inner product of q0 with a1. That's the length, times the vector q0, which is of length 1. So that gives us this dashed line right here. And then if we take that vector and we subtract it off of a1, we get the vector perpendicular. This dashed vector plus that vector is equal to a1. Therefore, if you take a1, you subtract out the component in the direction of q0, you end up with a component that's perpendicular to q0, and that's the component of a1 perpendicular to q0. Now, If you take that vector and you simply move it so that it's rooted at the origin, then we have a vector that is perpendicular or orthogonal to Q0. All we then have to do is make that vector of length 1, and we have two vectors that are mutually orthonormal, Q0 and Q1. And if you look at this picture carefully, you will notice that this vector points in the same direction as A1 perp. Now, if we let this rotate, you will also notice that the space spanned by A0 and A1 is the same space as is spanned by Q0 and Q1. So what did that animation show us? Well, it showed us how to compute the component of A perpendicular to Q0. And how did we do that? We did that by taking A1. We then computed the component of A1 in the direction of Q0, and this is the formula for that. And we subtracted that component in the direction of Q0 from A1, leaving us with the component of A1 perpendicular to Q0. We'll call it A1 perp. It will become convenient later on to do this in two steps. The first is to compute the inner product of Q0 with A1. And the second one is then to subtract off that multiple of Q0 from A1 to compute A1 perp. Now let's look and see how this works with this specific example with which we started. This here is the vector Q0. We take the inner product of that vector with this new vector, 1, 2, 3. If we work it out, that turns out to be 2 times the square root of 3, if I did this right. Once we have that scalar, we then take the vector A1. We subtract off row 0, 1 times Q0. Now it's convenient that this square root of 3 times that square root of 3 is 3, so that this simply becomes minus 2 times the vector 1, 1, 1. And if you work through it, you end up with this vector minus 1, 0, 1. And that is the component of A1 perpendicular to the vector Q0. So now we have two vectors, Q0 and A1 perp, that are orthogonal to each other. The problem is that A1 perp is not of length 1. To fix that, what we do is we take our vector Q1 perp, and we divide it by its length, and we call the result of that Q1. We will again do this in two steps. The first is to compute the length of A1 perp, and the second one is to divide A1 perp by that length. If we do that with the specific example we have, this was the vector that we computed as the component of A1 perpendicular to Q0. The length of that is square root of 2. And then if we take that vector and we divide it by the square root of 2, we can write that either as this vector right here, or we can explicitly multiply through to get the individual components.